So I want to start by telling you about Meg, a 56-year-old lady who recently had her first grandchild, Connor. And we recently admitted Meg to our inpatient rehabilitation unit for people with severe obesity to kickstart her journey to a healthier life. Now that involves 6 weeks of an 1,100 calorie a day diet, input from the full multidisciplinary team, including dietetics, psychology, physiotherapy. At the start of the 6 weeks, she weighed 157.5 kilos. At the end of the 6 weeks, she weighed 157.5 kilos. You'd probably think she was disappointed, but not so. Car transfers were now independent, mobility much improved, personal hygiene and dignity way better. Her treatments for diabetes, blood pressure, and sleep apnea way reduced. She was delighted. She could go and visit Connor now when she wanted and pick him up and hold him easily. And also important to Meg was she understood now for the first time why her multiple unsuccessful attempts at weight loss had not been her fault. During my career, population obesity has doubled, but the numbers living with severe obesity has gone up 1,200%, absolute explosion. And that's been driven by an environment that causes overconsumption and sedentary behavior as the norm. We have a food and drinks industry that say we no longer promote in any way, shape, or form to under 12s. And yet they use the top baby names from the last 4 or 5 years for their bars and their bottles. These have been their most successful campaigns ever in terms of boosting sales. If you're 5 and you see your name on a bottle, it's not your name on a bottle, it's your bottle. We also have the industry producing products designed specifically for the bliss point of a 3-year-old's palate. And they now place those products at that child's eye level in packaging specifically designed to be attractive to the 3-year-old's brain. And they're let do it. Prevention is different from treatment. Take this picture from an Australian beach in the 1970s. If you took that picture today, a lot would be different. But the main difference would be there would be umbrellas everywhere, and there'd be hats and t-shirts on almost everyone. So you get the skin cancer melanoma because you get too much sun for your genes. There are people who lie on sunbeds and don't get melanoma. You're not told when you get that skin cancer that your treatment is to put on sunscreen and wear a hat. Your treatment is surgery and drugs. And the prevention piece is important, but it's to stop you getting more skin cancer. If you move to obesity, you develop obesity because you get too much energy from the toxic environment for your genes. There are people who eat 3,000 calories a day and don't have obesity. And there are people like Meg. So why are we still telling people with obesity that their treatment is to eat less and move more? It's not. Their treatment is obesity surgery and now some of the newer medication we have. And yes, the prevention piece is important, but it's to stop you developing further obesity. About 20 years ago now, because our patients were getting over 200 different diseases being driven by obesity, we started to look at our patients' defense against illness, our patients' immune system. And we started to take a blood sample from every patient at their first visit. So we took just under a tablespoon of blood, 10 mils. And that 10 mils of blood contains 20 million immune cells. It's incredible. And they're divided into subtypes that have different roles in the defense against illness. And our overall theory is pretty simple. Obesity is driven by multiple factors. That obesity then causes a marked effect on your body's immune system. And then you develop disease based on your family history many years earlier than you might have otherwise. I only want to mention one cell type in particular. It's the iNKT cell. It's been called the Swiss Army knife of the immune system. It can do any job, but it's best left as a regulator. And it has a vital role in how fat tissue functions in our body. And what we were seeing was that our patients with obesity were losing their iNKT cell population. And what we've shown is that this causes not just the obesity-related diseases, but it actually causes further obesity to develop. This is fat tissue, real time. You've got the blood vessels in red, supplying the fat cells in black. And you have the immune cells moving around the blood vessels, all the time talking to each other, sometimes cell-to-cell contact, sometimes just passing by, but all the time instructing each other and instructing the fat cell. And we've worked out what's going on, and we're finally beginning to understand obesity better. The iNKT cell is running the show. It's telling the other cells what to do, it's telling the fat cell what to do, and it's regulating energy burn, calorie burn in fat. Is understanding this important? Well, I think it is, because it helps us understand certain situations that we know affect weight. So when you start treatment with steroids or antipsychotic medication, people say, you're just eating more and you gain weight. But in fact, when you start these treatments, you dial down iNKT activity, dial down calorie burn, and gain weight. When you smoke, you dial up iNKT activity, dial up calorie burn, and lose weight. So when you stop smoking, you gain weight, even if you eat the same. And we all know people who've used smoking to control their weight. Now, you may have heard of Ozempic or Mounjaro. They're treatments that we have available now for managing diabetes and more recently obesity. They're based on a hormone called GLP-1. It's a hormone you release from your own gut when you eat a meal. And it goes to your brain and makes you feel a bit full, and it stimulates insulin release. In your body, it only lasts for 90 seconds. But the pharmaceutical industry have developed it into a once-a-week injection. However, the main narrative, even within the obesity field, is that these treatments make you eat less, and that's how they work. But if our belief that the treatment of obesity isn't simply eat less, move more, then these treatments need to be doing something else. And that's what we've shown. When you start treatment with GLP, you wind up iNKT number and activity, wind up calorie burn, and this drives the weight loss in addition to the reduced appetite. The emergence of these new treatments has the potential to transform our attitude to obesity as a chronic disease for the good. But this is not happening. The cultural desire to be thin has led to a celebrity hijacking of this entire space. There are ads for the skinny pen to look good in your summer photos in train stations and airports. There's easy access through your local cosmetic outlet or hairdresser. The result? A global shortage of supply for patients who need it on medical grounds, and a rising street value. But I want to finish by going back to Meg. She's already kickstarted her journey to a healthier life with our team. Just imagine her future if she had access to obesity surgery and these new treatments as part of her effort. Her diabetes treatments would be gone. Her sleep apnea machine would be in the bin. She would have a transformed future, a life totally transformed. Thank you.